So we shall now discuss regarding complications of massive transfusion protocol or MTP. One of the important complications of massive transfusion protocol that is given in older books is coagulopathy. I have today tried to explain to you the fact that we are trying to minimize this coagulopathy because trauma also causes coagulopathy. We are trying to minimize this by using a pressurized rapid infuser with an inline warmer that will warm the blood component so that the hypothermia component can be minimized. We are giving PET RBCs to treat the acidosis component. So whatever derangements are contributing to bleeding, we are trying to address them. So in older books, you will notice that coagulopathy is one of the biggest complications of MTP. But now the concept is that coagulopathy is the trigger for MTP. Coagulopathy contributes to massive transfusion protocol being initiated. So our objective is now to basically control this coagulopathy. If you are able to control this, still person dies. Then the cause of death is trolley. Please appreciate the point. Coagulopathy was the trigger because of which he was bleeding. You have been successfully able to treat the coagulopathy patient, but still the person died. He did not die of bleeding, he died of non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Or another reason could be that you have achieved a volume overload, like he was a heart disease patient and you did a volume overload, that is TACO. So if you read a question that says a person after massive transfusion protocol is having development of respiratory distress, then don't answer coagulopathy is the cause of death. Because coagulopathy will contribute to bleeding and shock. You have already addressed that, and the person is having respiratory distress, then the answer in the question is transfusion-related acute lung injury. You see, questions nowadays are clinical-oriented. So he said massive transfusion protocol was initiated in a patient of OBGY cause, like a postpartum hemorrhage, and the person had developed respiratory distress. What could be the reason or etiology behind it? Then there are two etiologies. Either it is trolley or it is transfusion-associated circulatory overload. And how would you differentiate between them would be one, the value of blood pressure in the question, because blood pressure values will be increased in circulatory overload. In trolley, the values of B-type natriuretic peptide will be normal, but BNP levels will always be increased in cardiogenic pulmonary edema, that is transfusion-associated circulatory overload in the patient. So do remember the fact that trolley and TACO are two reasons for respiratory distress after a massive transfusion protocol, and our objective is to clear the coagulopathy part component in the patient. So coagulopathy, I'm not saying that coagulopathy will not be seen. Yeah, it can be seen, but our objective is to clear that. So if he begins by saying that a transfusion protocol patient is having distress or is having increased blood pressure, cardiogenic pulmonary edema or crepitations in the chest, then these two possibilities have to be kept. And the two more causes to be remembered are development of electrolyte imbalance, hyperkalemia. Why that? Because packed RBCs were stored at lower temperature, they might be near their expiry date, so therefore their sodium potassium pumps have shut down due to depletion of glucose. So if the pumps will shut down, they will not be able to send potassium inside the RBCs, and therefore the blood potassium levels would be elevated. So hyperkalemia can contribute to diastolic arrest. So if he says after blood transfusion in a patient there is a bradycardia, then it is hyperkalemia that is occurring in a patient. On the other hand, if he says that a person after massive blood transfusion is having difficulty in breathing, there is a development of stridor in the patient, but the chest is clear, then it could be tetany occurring in a patient. So I'll just highlight the facts once again so that you can understand this. For respiratory distress, there can be three possibilities in a patient. Respiratory distress could be due to trolley, it could be due to TRACO, or it could be due to laryngospasm that will trigger a difficulty in breathing in the patient. You will notice that pulmonary edema will be a feature of trolley and TACO. Trolley would be non-cardiogenic, TACO would be cardiogenic pulmonary edema. And laryngospasm, the chest of the patient will be bilaterally clear, but you might be able to hear adventitious sounds. Those adventitious sounds are the sounds which are coming from the upper airway because there is a laryngospasm developing in a patient. But if he says there's a bradycardia occurring in a patient, then you have to think in terms of hyperkalemia in a patient. So complications of blood transfusion are obviously asked in the exam, and I've discussed them separately also with respect to transfusion biology. But here my main objective of discussing them and highlighting before you was just to sensitize you to the fact that in older questions they were not giving any clinical information. They were just saying massive transfusion protocol, person is still bleeding, what is the cause? Coagulopathy. But now they're saying he's having respiratory distress in the patient. Then answer is obviously not coagulopathy. It would be either two or three in a patient, or even five if the chest of the patient is clear. We have to keep our, I would say, senses open to the fact that these permutation combinations could be occurring in the patient. So these are details, guys, that I wanted to remember for this topic. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll continue with another topic.